I love not reading about movies and actors, because then you go to the theatre and it's fresh. You don't know what shoe size they are or how many people they've slept with, or you just see the character. I love the fact that, you know, there are some actors that you simply don't know much about and that they keep themselves very much to themselves, and I'm really grateful for that.
So how is that for you? I mean, you've been
out and about, flaunting myself, totally.
Well, you're not a
contradicting
tabloid.
Contradicting what I'm currently saying.
Never really been a tabloid girl.
No, I settled down early, I guess.
An eight-year-old child.
Been married for 10 years. You know, no dramas there, and well, not that anyone knows about. And you know, I think the other reason is that I was at school. I started when I was 16, but then I was constantly going back to school, and school in parallel with work. I mean, I was at Cambridge University, and I made 5 movies in 3 years when I was reading my degree there. That kind of stopped me from getting involved in the whole social scene.
Right.
You know.
So do you look at your pictures in the past and kind of, can you see them as something that's just a movie at this point, or are they all scrapbooks of your life?
Oh, I don't know. I don't really ever do go back and watch them. I never do, actually. It's partly because there aren't that many hours in every day that you can go back and watch things, and you know, that you've already been there, done that. And also, I think that it's because I had the experience, and that's still fresh. I can conjure that up at any point, the memory of it. Seeing the movies that I've done is less evocative for me than just thinking about the memory of them. Obviously, because I was so much more involved than, you know, you will be watching it. I think probably what would be nice is watching maybe 1% of them with my kids. That would be cool. And I'm trying to think which one. Ripley saw Norbit. My eldest is Ripley. She's 8. And was kind of unimpressed, but fairly enjoyed it quite a lot. But was really unimpressed, though. In fact,
unimpressed that you were in it, or just
unimpressed. Just unimpressed that I was in it. Unimpressed. Mm-hmm. She's proud of me. She's really proud of me. She's very proud when I receive accolades and respect in that respect. She's really proud. And I can tell that she's kind of got a mental note of what she wants to achieve. I don't know whether that's good or bad, but it seems to be a fairly positive thing. But I was telling, I was for a couple of years, I was like, we got to watch Home Alone. It's really great. No. It went on for about a year, and I'm like, why doesn't she want to watch Home Alone? I said, babe, it's really good. I think you'll really enjoy it. I'm not going to watch another film that you're in. I said, well, number one, I'm not in it. So number two, why not if I'm in it? And I'm sure it's just a bit weird watching your mum.
Yeah.
Watching anyone that you know. I mean, the number of times really close friends of mine have watched movies and just said the worst, most insensitive, dumbass things, just because it's an odd thing to have someone that... My dad is terrible. He is the single worst. He's actually quite... He's got much better having been coached by my husband, but...
Being just, critical of your work, or...
Just not big on the sensitivity. It's like, no, it's quite good. It didn't really hang together, though. When he saw Mission Impossible, the first thing he said, first thing in the premiere, like the party, didn't really hang together, though, the storyline, did it? Which is crushing to me. Which has got nothing actually to do with the movie.
Right.
It's got more to do with, you know, wanting my dad to be proud. And.
Though, ironically, I have another one of your relations. So Paul Haggis and I have a running joke that his father and I dislike his writing. Really? That there's, like, this running thing that I dislike the script.
And his dad still likes the script. I love that about Haggis.
Yeah. No, he's a great guy.
I love that about Haggis.
Yeah.
He's not going to just dismiss your relationship because you're not into his work.
Well, he wants to hear both sides. And, you know, I don't always
don't
dislike
like?
His writing, I got to say.
It's what have just... you liked and what not liked?
I have mixed feelings about
there
Crash.
There aren't that many.
Yeah, there aren't that many. I love Facts of Life. I was a big fan of that the other day. But, no, I liked In the Valley of Elah a lot.
I liked that movie. God,
and
that was
unfortunately,
chilling.
It didn't get released very well.
I watched it on DVD.
Yeah.
The scene with the soldier at the end when he fesses up about what happened.
Yeah.
The great thing about Paul is he earns moments like that. Like moments that are so shocking that they almost seem... they could, with another writer, they could seem contrived. just for that moment of, oh, I'm going to shock the audience.
Right.
But I think the reason is just that he does his research and he knows that this is the human nature, this is the truth. And it's and he dares to do it. You know?
He also dares to be natural in a certain way that other that isn't so screenplay-y or isn't so movie-like.
That's his people, TV background, probably.
Which I think people, the critics, discount a lot of the time, but actually ends up working for audiences.
Love it. Yeah. Well, they were so hungry for Crash. I was really shocked. Yeah. Really shocked. Of course. I mean, it was, you know, it was palpable in the Academy Awards when it won Best Film. For most people, it was like, eh? What?
Yeah. No, that was
but
a very unusual year.
But it. Very unusual.
Well, was it, in many ways, that was a situation where getting it out there and kind of saying, we want to be part of this story, people went to their
life.
Natural reflexes in a
it
way.
It was about life. It was about the need, you know, it was about the evolution of America, for sure, and the need to have a forum to just get their shit out and admit things and, you know, reconciliation. All power to the Haggis as a result. Yeah.
Well, my thing with that movie was structure only, you know, and that was the running conversation with Halal and I, because we actually did Q&As for the movie and did all kinds of stuff in public, and it really was, I just not a fan of the structural coincidences of the picture.
Okay,
it was
a little too much
for me.
Sure,
but I think, you know, in terms of the filmmaking, in terms of the performances, in terms of so much that he got, it works as a picture, so it's an odd
thing.
So
did you talk to him about that before he went to film it?
No, we had the first conversation.
What use is that then?
I saw the picture in Toronto right after Lionsgate, right before Lionsgate bought it, I guess.
And so you weren't friends before?
We were not friends. We had met a couple times through social occasions, but we didn't really know each other. And then actually I wrote a review that started, God, I can't believe I'm talking about this with you, but it started, I hate Crash, and then explained why I was having a problem with Crash. And I got a call from Lionsgate and said, would you mind having lunch with Paul? And we sat down and had lunch, and it was
amazing.
Civil as could be, and he said, you know, I'm not going to defend my movie to you, but, you know, we can talk about it.
I mean, that's the whole point, is that it's provocative.
Yeah.
And if you hate something, it's like an itch that you've got to scratch. You've got to figure out why you hate it, and that is valuable for a movie like that.
Yeah.
If it's a piece of shit, stupid, piece of puff, and you hate it, that's just not, there's nothing to be gained.
Well, filmmakers, though, always have the love of something, you know, there's something that people always talked about. It always drove me crazy with Siskel and Ebert when they would say, oh, somebody just tried harder, they would make a better, this could have been a better movie. And you realize, even bad movies, somebody's trying really hard.
So hard.
Yeah.
So, that's why, actually, every movie, there's something to like.
Yeah.
There is.
If you want to see it. And that's, I guess, not the job of a critic sometimes, but
yeah. It's an odd thing, isn't it? How's it going to be in the future? I guess it's just going to be downloading everything.
Well, marketing has eaten everything. You know, the marketing is so huge now.
It is so, it's bigger than anything. I mean, I know that from my point of view because the time I spend doing the marketing is like 90%, and then there's 10% they're actually doing it. And I mean, for some reason in the last couple of years, I'm really fighting that. I can't stand it, actually. Partly because I talk myself into hating what I've done. It's like, can't we just leave a little element of mystery? Also, I think, you know, we're hunter-gatherers. We like to discover things. There's nothing like discovering that movie. Mm-hmm. Even if it's 10 years after it was made.
Yeah.
And you sit in your living room and you turn the TV on and this movie comes on. You don't know what to expect and there it is. You feel like you've discovered it, you know. And that's the beauty, as opposed to just being... It's like in WALL-E. At the end, when they're all massive and they're in those things and everything's delivered to them. Mm-hmm. That's what it's like with movies now.
Well, that's what we just had the experience in Sunday at Toronto, where the two movies that kind of got the biggest play in the festival were completely unexpected, with Slumdog Millionaire and the Wrestler. Kind of they became this huge phenomenon because nobody saw them coming.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's so much better,
I mean, they're good movies and they deserve the attention and everything else. But in a way, coming there with, you know, Rocknrolla comes to Toronto and it's a machine and it's a big deal and thinking about. And these little things come in, it's like, oh my God, precious objects.
Yeah. But then you see how the marketing then tries to predict those little ones,
which
the whole reason why it's an anomaly and fabulous is because you weren't expecting it. That's the whole point. So you can't create the unexpected. Do you know what I mean? But they try. It's so annoying.
Every once in a while, they do a good job. Like Juno last year was completely a marketing effort, but
do you think that was part of the success of the movie? Was the marketing?
Yeah. They completely saw it. They treated it like it was an independent film, when in fact it was, in many ways, a Judd Apatow film. You know, it was the same kind of slam-bam smart talking, all that stuff. I mean, it's a good movie, but it's, you know, it had a lot of the elements that a teenage release would normally have.
Yeah.
And yet somehow it was indie. It was art.
So it made people feel like they were way groovy watching it.
Yes. Well, you know, Britta likes to feel
groovy. My favorite movies this year? Hands down, Pineapple Express.
Are you telling us something about yourself that we should know?
No, I'm just thinking about Juno, thinking about movies that you don't expect.
Right.
I think it's genius. Writing, performance, everything. The fact that it's so postmodern, the way it's just the homages to different things. Oh, God, it was awesome.
So did it take you completely by surprise, or did you know going in? Or?
I hated Knocked Up, but I really liked 40-Year-Old Virgin. So it was like, I might like it, I might not. Right. And then I knew it was about pot. I thought that was going to be good. Or it's got the potential.
Right.
Because that's quite brazen. And there it was, just, oh, beautiful. I laughed so, it was just amazing to just have such a gigantic physical reaction to something. Yeah. You know, every other second. I mean, it was so, there were laughs coming from so many different parts of my body that my husband would have to actually kind of like hit me on the back like I was choking on something just to get all the laughs out at the same time.
Well, you really are a movie fan.
Because I like that movie?
No, because you like movies. You seem to
love movies. I do. And I don't love movies, like, I'm not obsessed with them.
Right.
I mean, it's partly because I'm a mum, so I don't have time. And there's simply, if it's like being with my kids for an hour and a half, or watching a movie, it's got to be a movie I can watch with my kids. So at the moment, it's really annoying for my 8-year-old because I'm pushing her into movies that I want to see, partly out of nostalgia, like, you're going to love Karate Kid. And she hates it. And also, if she feels me pushing her towards anything, the resistance is like, but I have tried. So in the last few, and I'm not going to get her to see things that I want to see currently, like as an adult. This is just stuff that I probably would have wanted to see when I was 13, when she, you know, she's 8. So I'm slightly accelerating her development. But I made her watch The Wiz the other night, and I realized halfway through she wasn't even in the room. She'd gone. She just wasn't in the freaking room, and I'm still glued. Oh, Michael, look at him when he was young.
And you guys watched The Wizard of Oz together, though. Did she go for that, or no?
She watched The Wizard of Oz with someone else. Traitor. that wasn't one of my favorites, though. I really was freaked out by the monkeys.
Still?
Not now, no. It's just not something... it doesn't do it for me, but The Wiz did.
So Norbit is, in your house, a family film?
I can't believe how, but it is so exquisite, it's so like life, that the one movie my beautiful little girl, my intelligent, gifted little girl likes that I've done, the only one that she's seen, is Norbit, which has got to be the single worst film ever made.
Well, it's very silly, but it's a pretty amazing performance, I thought, by Eddie. I mean, I think that was the reason to watch that movie, was to watch those characters.
Oh, God, you know, the reason I say that is just because the script was so good, it was so dark, it was filthy. It was bad, it was nasty. And as a result, it kind of had more resonance and was more provocative, interesting. And I don't know, I just felt that it was more politically correct. And I'm not into political correctness necessarily, but I mean, literally, it was just more politically astute when it really pushed it to the edge. It just gradually got sort of watered down into this.
They went to the PG-13.
Yeah, and I was so disappointed.
Yeah, I was shocked when I first saw it how kind of rough it was. But it wasn't quite rough.
The ending, when they speed him up, she gets plugged in the bum, and they speed her up. It's like, what kind of filmmaking is that, man?
Well, Brian Robbins not getting an Oscar anytime soon.
Well, you know.
Oh, very nice.
But he's a really nice guy, and he and Eddie work well together.
So did you in doing Condi? I mean, Condi is, you haven't seen the movie yet. I have seen the movie, so I have a slight advantage on you.
I should be interviewing you.
There you go. Tell you all about the movie. But your performance, one of the most interesting things about the movie to me was that some people chose to do nothing other than do themselves. Richard Dreyfuss is Richard Dreyfuss. Mm-hmm. You know, he's not really channeling Dick Cheney in any way. Didn't even shave his head in a funny way or anything. Like, I mean, it was like he's Richard Dreyfuss.
Yeah.
You are Condie Rice in this movie. I mean, it's a completely physical transformation. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't really know it was you unless you knew it was you, I think, in the picture. Did you learn that watching Eddie do everything with makeup, or did you just make a decision? I mean, you've never really done anything quite like this.
No, I haven't.
Before.
But before we go into that, though, I want to know how that felt for you, not just as a person in the audience, but as a seasoned film professional. The fact that some of us were, you know, obviously Josh and myself, were doing that, and then other actors weren't. How was that for you?
It's always a mixed bag. There's like every year there, well, not every year, but there have been a number of movies, particularly German movies, movies about Germany and Nazi Germany, where filmmakers make decisions to have everybody speak in their natural language or to go colloquial or go to, you know, these foreign accents or whatever. And it's always a mixed bag. You're kind of sitting there looking at it funny. In this case, I think the movie kind of is more than that. In a way, by not forcing everybody to do it. For instance, I'm of course going to blank on his name, but
Scott Glenn.
No, the fellow playing
Jeffrey Wright.
No, the guy playing
James Cameron.
We're getting closer. No, the guy playing HW instead of W. Dad, Poppy.
James
Cromwell. Cromwell. There you
James
go.
James Cameron.
Jamie Cromwell. Yes.
Jamie Cromwell. Yeah.
Terrific
Same
actor,
thing.
But not doing. He's
he
doing himself.
He talked about that. He talked about that. He started off
trying to channel him.
Yeah. But then it was a scene that went off book and became much more emotional, and he lost his accent just because that's very often does happen.
Yeah.
And Oliver said, forget about the accent. I want to feel what's happening here.
Yeah.
This feels real to me. Not just feels real in this moment, feels real between these two people that we know.
Right. Well, there are moments, well, that's the thing, is that acting, to me, is uniformly excellent in the picture. It's, he, you know, picked a really great cast. So there's nobody who's really slacking, but it's just, it isn't, there are moments where you're kind of going, because Josh is just falls right into it. I mean, Josh, at moments.
And you know, he doesn't fall, he climbs right into it.
Yeah.
He worked so hard, and it wasn't like precious so hard, he just worked like it was like he was in training for something, for something really serious. Like it was like training for the Olympics, honestly. He was training for as Bush, and falling into it, sure, but
well, he makes it look natural. That's
does.
The thing, it's such
he
a
really does
comfortable performance.
And you know, look, a lot of most of my stuff was with him. So it actually served us well that we were both doing that kind of transformation. And for me, the reason why I had to is because I could not look in the mirror as Condi Rice looking like me. I couldn't have done it. It would have been bullshit. I'm 15 years younger than she was at the time. I don't sound like her. My jaw isn't like her. My eyes aren't like her. The way I laugh is different. Everything. And the thing is, she is a construct. Absolutely. That is part of who, that's a huge part of who she is. She's a performance all the time. So for me not to play the performance would have been missing the point.
It was
a comment on her, the fact that I completely changed. Because I think that who knows who she is? Who knows who she ever could have been? Truly, if she'd been able to feed off that ignition of soul and self that happens as you're a kid. But she didn't. She, you know, and look, I'm not commenting, there's not a negative. It's not derisive, it's just that she is the most disciplined human being I've ever read about, ever thought about. You know, from the very beginning, she's on the piano. From the very beginning, she's figure skating. From the very beginning, she's making decisions about her future that no kid makes. And so she has constructed herself. She's bulletproof. And I had to play that construct. And so it was, and also because I'm so different to her. When I sat down with Oliver in his office, So there might not be a lot for you to do, which is what I'm worried about, actually. You know, whether are we going to be looking at you over looking at the other characters? That's kind of going to be a problem for me. But can you be wallpaper? You know, can you? And I'm thinking, are you fucking out of your mind? I've been playing like hotties for the last 6 years. You know, I'm not too embarrassed about it, but I'm a tiny bit. You know, because I'm an artist. I'm creative, but it's like I've this weird sort of atrophy is sort of come over my the way I view my career, or myself in my career. And here's someone who is just very casually and not even confidently, just asking me to go back to what I truly love to do. It was such a gift. It was amazing. And also the last like year or two, I haven't got roles because I'm too attractive. And that's just because I've done that whole red carpet thing since Crash. Because there's been a lot going on since then, and a lot of the movies that I've done have called for that kind of marketing thing. So as a result, I'm like a dolly bird. And it's very hard for filmmakers and for, you know, studios to not use that, because that is what's potent, because people buy magazines, and it's the whole marketing thing. So to have Oliver Stone just clear that all off the table and remind me that actually you're a character actress. Mm-hmm. It was the most beautiful request, and I was terrified. And I just went to work. And, you know, we could talk for 20 minutes about exactly what I did, because it was very, it was sort of theatre. There was no emoting and who is she? How can I, because you know, after I read two biographies, it's like, right. I'm never going to feel anything, because I'm not even sure that she does. She's not a reflective person. She can't bear introspection at all. I mean, doesn't that, that's pretty clear looking at all of them. Not a lot of introspection. Never looking back, always looking forward. And so as a result, it was just all about doing a Cindy Sherman, you know? Hmm. I did think about Cindy Sherman when I was thinking about Condi, and I thought about Maggie Thatcher as well. They were the two, well, I didn't really think about Cindy Sherman, but her work, and then Maggie Thatcher as a person.
Right.
That whole kind of construct, finishing school. And in fact, I'm telling you, if you look at Maggie Thatcher and you look at Condi Rice, the similarities are scary.
Well, the physicality, I mean, it's interesting that watching the performance, I recognize things that I've seen in passing of her, but that I didn't really notice, because we really don't see her very much. It's not like she's a, we're not nearly as familiar with her or any of the cabinet people as we are with Bush.
No, you know, she's very, she's freeze frame.
Yeah, but also those angles, your body, your physicality, not just your face, and your speech patterns.
I watched. It was so gorgeous. It was like, you know, I'm an anthropologist. That's what I read at Cambridge, and it was like doing a case study of a different species, you know, because I can't think of another person more unlike myself, you know, and not species. That's not right. Another culture or something. And so yeah, but the best stuff. I did all the kind of obvious stuff first, watched the Charlie Rose documentary, interviews, and No End in Sight, these great documentaries that have a lot of, you know, her public persona and her speaking in public and so on. But the best stuff was like digging around on YouTube and finding those 1 minute long bits of footage of people with their mobile phones, recording her when she's not on camera. Her dancing to Shaggy at some event. It's like, wow, that's how she dances? She's black and she dances like that? Wow. You know, just interesting. And then it was about joining the gap between that person and the person we see. And that's who I played in the movie, is the person in between that. And I, you know, I loved it. And I don't know if I can ever play a Dolly Bird again.
Was it hard to perform doing that with other people not necessarily doing that? I mean, is it a... When you're on a set and you've got, because you really are a group of people mostly in the movie together. It's usually six or seven of you in a scene.
Yeah. And you never know where the camera is.
Yeah.
There's three cameras going at once. You don't know if it's on your fingers or on your hair or not on you at all. So I was permanently in character.
So you're just focused on your character and you're not really worrying about what everybody else is doing so much.
And it's very, very interesting how the dynamics between us as people and also what you're saying about me being like that and someone else, not necessarily. Even if that ever irritated me or if I ever put someone off because I was so condelicious, it would work somehow. You know? I really irritated Jeffrey Wright, and it was beautiful. Beautiful. Because it had that feeling of Colin Powell and Condi Rice.
Yeah, you didn't get a feeling he was sense that he was not irritated through the entire picture. Like every moment of the movie, he's angry at somebody.
So yeah, rightly so. He's amazing, Jeffrey Wright.
Yeah.
He's a really, really powerful. He makes you uncomfortable watching him. You know those actors that actually make you uncomfortable? Mm-hmm. They're the best. How uncomfortable does Daniel Day-Lewis make you feel?
Yeah.
So uncomfortable. And in that shifting around is when you realize what the fucking truth of it is, you know?
Of course, Daniel's probably more uncomfortable than anybody else.
Watching himself.
Yes, or even just being.
His performance in There Will Be Blood, wow. I kind of find it annoying because I don't know, Oscars and things, I just get annoyed about the popular vote and pitching one person against another and a performance. But, you know, it's part of our industry and there's a lot of good things that come from it, obviously. When a performance like that, which is so exciting, so interesting, so good, wins a big glitzy award, it's like, oh, I just wish this was something that was in a dark tunnel somewhere that we had to do something to go and find. Not that it's just given to you, we should have to earn the right to watch a performance like that, you know?
Well, that's almost a theater feel.
Yeah, you have to get out of your house, go through the cold wind of New York with your coat up, and you wait in line, you might not get a ticket, and then you fucking get to watch it.
And it won't be there.
And it might be his understudy.
Well, that was, yeah. I went through that the other day. I almost wanted to kill myself. But
oh, really?
Mark Rylance, who is a British actor who is stunning in Boeing.
Oh.
I don't think I've ever seen a stage performance that was better than that performance. And it's a silly performance in some ways, but brilliant, brilliant performance. And we went back, and I took my wife to go see it because I really wanted her to see that performance. I felt it was like Lorette Taylor or something, you know, like something you have to see.
Yeah.
And then he was out that day. I was like,
ouch.
And the other actors were great, you know, show works.
How did she feel?
She was angry at me because I ruined the movie. She had the show for her by bitching and moaning through the whole thing.
You didn't through the whole thing.
Well, not through the whole thing, but for the first 20 minutes before the show started, I was like,
you're disappointed. You couldn't let it go.
No, I couldn't. I was
you thought
bad.
That your bitching and moaning would miraculously bring Mark Rylance
I thought he would
stage.
Hear me somehow, yes.
Yeah.
But alas, he did not. Aww. Painful. So really, no more Dolly words? Jumping back to that.
Well, here's the thing. I'm going to... It has changed how I feel, though, dramatically, and I'm so grateful for that. I really am. I think, you know, every little while, this happens with me anyway. I'm sure it happens to lots of people, though. There's something that wakes you up again, and you didn't even realize you were asleep. And also, I'm a mom. That's the best thing in my life, and it is wonderful, but I can't let that other thing just wither away. And I've enjoyed the work that I've done. I really love doing Rocknrolla. Pursuit of Happiness was very interesting, very difficult but interesting. But these little roles where I then go dormant in between.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't researched and really thoroughly committed myself to a character of any kind of import for a long, long time. And I just have to. I have to.